test for all of its diversity. One could consider neuroscience as being concerned with two great problems: the problem of hardwiring and the capacity it has for plasticity. The hardwiring problem refers to how connections develop, how neurons communicate with each other, how organisms inborn functions are organized, like sleep-wake cycles and hunger and thirst, and our ability to perceive the world. The point is that through evolution, the nervous system has inherited many adaptations that are too important to be left to the vagaries of individual experience. In contrast, the capacity for plasticity refers to the fact that nervous systems can adapt or change as a result of experiences that occur during an individual lifetime. So the experiences we have can modify the nervous system, and as a result, we can learn and we can remember. This image from the Greek island of Santorini, Memory Hotel, a place where we might form new memories and revisit old ones, reminds us that memory is personal, evocative, and intertwined with emotion, a fundamental part of who we are. The memory is also a large topic for fundamental research in neuroscience. What is it? How does it work? And research proceeds at many levels of analysis, from questions about the molecular and cellular events that underlie the synaptic changes that store memory, to more system-level questions about what memory is, whether it's one thing or many things, what brain systems are involved, and how these systems operate to support memory. And I'm going to say just a few words about these latter sorts of questions. Well, this is what we like to call a simplified drawing. It illustrates the primate visual system here. Rusty made some reference to it, where nearly one-third of the cortex is devoted to the processing of visual information, where more than 30 different areas are specialized for carrying out specific operations. Visual information from the external world first reaches the cortex at the back of the brain in area V1. And from that point, information is formed both in series and parallel among two prominent pathways: a ventral stream that's sometimes referred to as the white pathway, and a dorsal stream that's sometimes referred to as the Squire pathway. In the ventral stream, information ultimately reaches its pinnacle in area TE, here in the ventral surface of the temporal lobe, where representations are achieved by visual object quality, the size, the shape, the orientation, the color of objects. In the dorsal stream, information eventually reaches the parietal cortex, where representations are achieved about where an object is in space and what the computations are that are needed to reach out and get to the object. And from there, projections are directed to a number of cortical and subcortical target regions, for example, to the amygdala, as shown here, to connect perception to emotion, to the frontal lobes, shown here, in order to connect perception to action, and for our purposes, to the medial aspect of the temporal lobe, the inner aspect of the temporal lobe, to the hippocampus and related structures, for the purpose of transforming perception into memory. So if one damages or removes any of these areas up here, one finds a particular kind of visual deficit or visual spatial processing deficit. But if one of these damaged structures is damaged down here, one finds a memory impairment. This shows where the hippocampus and its related structures are, where they sit in the human brain. Now, this is not a memory center. This is not a storehouse of memories. Rather, this is the machinery, as Rusty actually alluded to. This is the machinery that cooperates with cortex to form memories, which are then stored in a distributed fashion in cortex as extensions of the perceptual processes that originated them. It was the location of this system in the three species that contributed most to this tradition of work: the human brain, the monkey brain, and the rat brain, which could also be the mouse brain. You might see in the hippocampus, which is buried beneath the surface, but here you're seeing the structures that are anatomically related to and adjacent to the hippocampus. So together, this whole set of structures is referred to as the medial temporal lobe memory system. And when this system is largely destroyed, memory is profoundly affected. So you can hear this. This is a horizontally oriented MRI scan of a patient that we had a chance to study for many years who became profoundly amnesic following an episode of viral encephalitis in 1992 at the age of 70. And with this, what you're seeing here in white is the area of damage. And what this virus did was essentially almost surgically carve out the medial temporal lobe memory system bilaterally. This patient was so impaired and so profoundly impaired in his memory, they didn't have the insight that he had a memory impairment because he didn't have the ability to form a digital image of himself as a result of the errors that he would have encountered. And our laboratory visited this individual more than 200 times during his lifetime, and he never came to recommend subjects are invited to draw a nonsense diagram, and then without forewarning, so 10 or 20 minutes later, they reconstruct it from memory. This is a typical control subject. It's not as hard as it sounds because you spent time drawing it. This is a nice average reproduction. This is LM's reproduction. It's very impaired, very impoverished compared to what a control subject or a healthy subject would do. But you can see it does represent some semblance of the original target. EP, on the other hand, was so impaired he didn't remember he'd drawn it until you're 15 minutes earlier and declined to make any kind of a guess. Well, one of the fundamental discoveries has been that despite the pervasive memory impairment associated with this kind of damage, which affects memory for facts, events, language, faces, music, spatial layouts, there are forms of experience that are preserved in these patients. An observation which led us to the perspective that memory is not a single faculty of the mind, but rather consists of a number of different abilities supported by different brain systems. So let me just quickly illustrate this idea and summarize what it means. Most of this work is done with monkeys, and this is a test, a classic test for monkeys. It's called delayed non-matching to sample. What happens is the animal first sees a junk object, displaces it between the raised reward, thereby guaranteeing the animal's attention to the object. The screen then comes down, and then many seconds or even several minutes later, the screen comes up, the objects have been rearranged, and now the animal begins reward by displacing the novel object, thereby indicating to the experimenter that he remembers the other, less interesting original object. A task of recognition memory, or a task of familiarity. Now, this contrasts there with a motor skill. We call this a motor skill test. The animal confronts a lifesaver, turns it onto a metal tube. The animal has an opportunity to play with it, move along the metal rod, negotiate it, and then return and remove it, and eat it as a reward. And the animal, over time, learns and gets better and better at that test. Let's look at the effect of these two types of lesions that I just described. A large middle temporal lobe lesion as in the first case, I'll describe a limited hippocampal lesion as in the second case. Here you see the results. Let's first look at the skill learning. All three groups, these are normal animals with limited hippocampal lesions like the corneal MRI that I showed you, and animals with large middle temporal lobe lesions like patient EP and the horizontal MRI that I showed you. 6 trials a day, the animals showed good overnight retention, gradual learning. 1 month later, they're perfect at doing the task. They become very fluid and they move it along to become skillful at doing the task. In contrast, these animals do very poorly on object recognition. Normal animals show some forgetting, as you'd expect, over a 10-minute delay. Hippocampal animals, for example, say middle temporal lobe patients, monkeys are so impaired that they reach chance level, 50% a coin flip, by 10 minutes. So, in other words, the same monkeys who are able to carry overnight retention of a motor skill, those same monkeys are unable to remember something they had an object for 10 minutes. Similar things are coming in humans. This is a well-known task, a task of reading mirror versus print. We're borrowed at first with these low frequency words. We get better and better at it until eventually, with much practice, one can read these as easily as normal print, hypnotic apocalypse, and functional. So, what this then leads us to is this idea of multiple memory systems, multiple kinds of long term memory. The fundamental distinction to be made is between our capacity for conscious declarative memory, which depends on the system that I'm talking about, and which supports the ability to learn facts and events, and an umbrella term of non-declarative memory, which is impaired, which is intact in the patients that I've described, a collection of unconscious abilities. Declarative memory can be brought forward as consciously as a representation or as an image. Declarative memory is the kind of memory we mean when we use the term memory in everyday language. In the case of non-declarative memory, performance changes as a result of experience and therefore deserves the term memory. We're talking about things like skills and habits and learning to read mirror first print. The performance changes without requiring any conscious memory content, or in some cases even awareness of it being used. So we're talking about skills and habits, perceptual learning like mirror reading, Dialog and conditioning, like the acquisition of phobias, for example, fear, motor skills, simpler. Phylogenetically simple kinds of learning like habituation. Declarative memory is expressed through recollection, non-declarative memory that Rusty talks about, which is capacity for neurogenesis in the spiculum, and these adjacent cortices, the anterior cortices. This is the middle temporal lobe system, which interacts with these cortical areas. And the thickness of the lines represent the robustness of the anatomical projections. These are bilateral projections, and it is an anatomical basis for how the middle temporal lobe can work together in